Hey, it's Fran, again, and I'm back at the historic John Wanamaker building in Center City, Philadelphia, for part two of the Wanamaker Organ, which is behind me. Scott Kipp is with me again, and we're going to go over and take a look at the console that is used to control this largest musical instrument in the world. Scott, so part one of the video that we shot, there were lots of comments about the battle between the Wanamaker organ, is the largest musical instrument in the world, and the organ that's in New Jersey.
Well, I'm not as familiar with the Atlantic City organ. You could say it depends, which is bigger, depends upon how you measure. We have more ranks. But they have another octave on their manuals, and they end up having more pipes. But they also have some bigger scale pipes than we have. They actually have a 64-foot open diapason where the pipes are built in, and it's 64-foot tall resonator, which we don't have. We have 32-foot open. And in terms of just cubic feet of space that it takes up, that's bigger. Theirs is bigger.
But how much of it is actually functional?
That they've gotten so much more of it working in the past year that I guess my answer would be I don't know. But there's quite a lot more done than there was this time just a year ago. They're going crazy down there. It's super busy, and they're doing amazing work.
Right. So at least for the time of this filming, it's the Wanamaker organ is still maintaining the title.
Yeah, but.
Who knows?
They're both unique in their own way. I think the Wanamaker organ is, of course I'm speaking as if I like play the organ or in any way musically trained, which I'm not, but I think the Wanamaker organ is much more subtle. Like it's made for subtlety, despite the fact that it's big and can play loud. Its subtlety is its sort of strength. And I guess it remains to be seen how much of that, though, we'll be able to get out of the Atlantic City organ. I don't really know.
Why don't you introduce?
So this is Matt Taft, the organ shop coordinator at Macy's, and he can explain the
the console.
Musical workings of the console.
You have a keyboard that we refer to as a manual, and there are six here, and one for your feet. That's the pedals are bigger and don't have the full scope of the whole keyboard. But each one of these manuals, you can assign different instruments to them, and each instrument section has a different correlated color tab to it. And it ranges from orchestral sounds like flutes, tibias, that's mostly what's in there, flutes and tibias. We've got a section of tabs to make sounds like human voices called the Vox Humana, and that's a whole room of several sets of these pipes. There's a section of the choir. There are string instruments that fill up the entire fourth floor of the organ, and pedal pipes that are 32 feet tall and so big you can put a pony in the top of it. And it's just a really amazing thing that there are structures that are so big and just get scaled down to several inches tall and such a smaller diameter, and each one is an individual musical note. If you put on this tab that says 8-foot trumpet and you press down the low C, there is one pipe that is 8 feet tall that makes the pitch of low C, and there's a reed in there to vibrate because we don't have little lips to vibrate on each one like you would playing a trumpet. There's one pipe that's 8 feet long to play that one note of the trumpet, and then there's another pipe that's a little bit shorter for the next note up, and then another one, and another one, 61 times, and oftentimes there's an extra octave at the top when you want a couple things, so there are 73 notes for this one tab.
And by notes, he also means pipe.
Pipes, yeah.
So 73 individual objects that are each individually adjusted and tuned mechanically to be in relationship to each, and that's just on one tab, and then each of those tabs, for the most part, has that. Which, so that's why there's so much of the organ.
Thousands and tens of thousands of pipes, individually handmade and hand-maintained, with all of their own little series of actions and pneumatics to make the air flow through them to play.
So explain the various sections of the console and what differentiates them.
Choir, then the great, then the swell, then the solo, then the ethereal and stentor.
Right? Stentor?
Yes. You can assign each of the colored tabs. They're home assigned to those layers. So you're conducting like you're an orchestra conductor, and you make these instruments play with these fingers here, and then when you want to conduct the other part of the orchestra, you move your hands up to something else. And you turn them on by tilting the tabs down, and you could do that again and again and again and again individually with all your fingers, but you're doing this live, and you're playing the music, so you have to have pre-assigned combinations of these tabs that are turned on, and that's what these round buttons are underneath. And you push them as you play, and if the console was on, it would energize the coils that Scott probably showed you inside to make the tabs move one direction or the other.
How many of these pre-programmed, preset buttons are there that can be programmed? It's quite a number, I know.
If you pause, I can count, and then.
But it's a number for each. Yeah. So each rank. Would these be ranks?
Ranks.
Okay.
And so you would push your piston, and it would go back. The signal would go to this. Did you show her?
Yeah, we looked on the inside.
Yeah. So that goes to the combination action, and then the electrical signals would be spat back out to turn the coils on or off.
And these all get the tablets. Is that what they're
yes.
called? They all get flipped by an actuator in the console.
Yeah.
Based on what's pre-programmed and for that setting, and this is for the entire organ can be changed in one button.
With one
push.
Button. Yeah.
And when they rock down or back, it is mechanically connecting an electrical signal that goes into the organ and turns on or off a rank of pipes.
So
there is a mechanical connection, a mechanical electrical connection being made when they move, which is what sends the signals into the organ, which then turns on the divisions. And then there's the notes. So there's the stop signaling, and then there's the note signaling.
And as we pointed out before I started shooting, even these, are these original light fixtures for
yeah.
the organ?
Yeah, yeah.
So these original light fixtures for the organ, they take tungsten tubes for illumination.
Long filaments.
It's an actual tungsten filament. It's not a fluorescent tube, but a tungsten tube, which I noticed that they do flicker. Like this one's flickering. It probably doesn't show up on the video because of the frame rate, but it's actually the tungsten bulb that the filament kind of wobbling around from the heat. So as I understand it, you have a lifetime supply of those replacement bulbs.
Yes.
Just in case.
So you can have the sounds turn on or off, your pre-programmed combinations of sounds, sort of like a radio station. And we could even have, just to throw in, FM1, FM2, so each organist can have their own preset combinations. And that goes up to like FM 100 for us. But you have the stops on, you're pressing down on the keys, air's flowing through the pipes, and music is coming out. Then there are these little gas pedal shaped things that you use to control the volume of the pipes. If the pipes are in a room that's enclosed with shades, they're like Venetian blinds, but for sound. And instead of light, it's sound. So
yeah.
when you press...
Which we saw in episode one.
Episode one, we showed the swell shades. And we even saw the actuator that controls those swell shades.
And you slide it up and down with your foot here, or on the manual, you can also have the expression open and closed. So if your feet are busy playing notes, you can be using your thumb.
So let me see that close up of that. So you actually have a little slider there, and that's doing exactly the same thing as the foot control.
You've got it.
All right, so you can do it by hand or by foot.
Oh, something else I want to point out since we're here.
Yeah.
And this, I think, isn't hooked up anymore because we've redone the combination action. But in the days before cell phones were so common, Kurt, the curator, who also worked for the telephone company for many, many years, installed, well, I don't think he installed the phone, but there's this phone here, which is still hooked up, but Kurt made it so that...
when you picked up the receiver.
When you picked up the receiver, you could make it so that these numbers here would actually dial the telephone, and it was connected to the phone lines in the building.
The numbers here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, these are buttons for the combination action, but you
but
could make it.
Phone.
But Kurt made it so they were also hooked into the phone, and you could dial and make phone calls from the console using that phone.
And of course, it is a 1930s era handset. So.
Yeah. But I think that's not hooked up anymore because. When we redid the console, well, I mean, the phone is hooked up. I don't think you can dial from there. But you can call that phone. And Kurt actually made it so that if the organ console was turned on, instead of the phone ringing, it would make the crescendo light there flash. So the organist would know the phone was ringing, but it wouldn't make a noise because they were playing.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But it might be disconnected now. So we have made some changes to this. When the orchestra came in 2008, Peter needed to be able to see the conductor, and so they had me make drop-down screen, which was made for, you know, installing in SUVs or whatever to entertain the children. But we put this here, so now we have a camera feed that can look at the conductor, and so Peter can... play. So I try to find ways to blend things like that in and not have the console look any different. And like I said, this was all built in the building here, which I think is pretty cool. So I just mounted it on the back there.
Nice. It's good work.
Yeah. I kind of want to remake it out of metal now that I'm learning how to make things out of metal, but...
So you're saying this whole thing, all the components, all the woodworking, all the metalworking was all done in the building?
Yes, this is all built in the building. And then also we have a new combination action. So the CA is the thing that records the settings, the registrations that the organists have, basically where the tabs are set. And we have a new electronic memory in the organ that takes care of that. So we put those components here in this drawer. Which I also need to, I kind of want to take the time and remake it, but this is the, you know, fun kind of thing I get to do. You know, occasionally I get to make pretty dovetail drawers too.
Wow. And you made that. Made this from scratch.
Yeah.
Oh, God,
it's attached with wires. Yeah, it's, you can't really see it. I was going to flip it over, but it's just packed with so much crap underneath there that I really want to make another one.
Yeah, look at that. So that's a shot we usually don't see as the, and again, this is interesting because it is a keyboard. You have the black keys and the white keys in pedal form. And what are the buttons called? Those?
Toe studs.
Toe studs.
They are pistons for your feet. And like you have the numbered pistons for your thumbs under the manuals, you've got pre-programmed ones that you can push with your feet.
And each one is named. You've got choir, great, swell, solo, ethereal, stentor, okay,
yeah. And crescendo.
Yes. And one of those studs. 2DFF, bombard, diaphone, gamba. These are all nicknames, I guess.
The black tabs are ranks.
Ranks. Diaphone?
Diaphone.
That is a lot.
It's really cool. And the 2Ds are sort of the three-stage crescendo, where you can activate a bunch of stops at one time by pushing that with your foot. It's a pre-programmed, mechanically programmed section of the organ that you have to go back and turn these little metal, like, rings on or off, and that when you press 2D1, the electrical signals go through that matrix that's still in line today, that bypasses the computer circuitry.
So some of it is still, some of the programming is still left.
You can be done mechanically by hand.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's the 2Ds. The electronic combination action that we have now is an upgraded hybrid system, because there was an electronic combination action put in before. There's the combination action and the relay. Both are huge upgrades.
What is the relay?
The relay is the relay race of information. You're passing the baton of, you know, you press down a key and it completes an electrical circuit. And that electrical signal then needs to travel to somewhere else, and that's the baton that's being passed. And you relay that information to throughout the organ to the different parts that need to work. And that, we have a lot of still mechanical relays, but we bypassed these old mechanical relays. It's a tall wooden block with a bunch of metal fingers on it that would inflate, and those metal fingers would touch contacts and then relay those electrical signals that are being generated when you press down on the keys to the pipes that have air pressurized underneath them to make them play. And we've bypassed the mechanical Rube Goldberg make this happen, then that happen to make 10 other things just keep going in succession. And it's a much more instantaneous, create this electrical signal, and within, I think it's 8 milliseconds, the signal gets to the valve for the note to play.
So this was something that Scott had mentioned before, that to play this organ, you have to be accustomed to the delay.
Yes.
So it's not like a modern synthesizer or an even electrical organ. You have to wait for what you're playing to be heard.
There was an organist who used to hum a different tune than he was playing, because if you listen to what you're playing, it just gets slower and slower and slower, and you would get so far out of time. So he would be whistling a different tune so his fingers could keep time.
So there's the time interval that it takes just to actuate the note that you press, but then there's also the time it takes for the sound to reach the console, because some of these organ pipes are quite far away.
Yes, and the echo division is, I think, about 120 feet in the air. And then there's that compound delay that happens with the mechanical relays, and then the air that has to go through the pipe and then make this pipe sound, and that distance is greater when you have taller pipes. So
there's actually a greater delay with the lower notes.
Yes.
With the higher notes. So playing this organ isn't a matter of like improvising by listening to what you're playing. You're mechanically pressing the keys based on sheet music, basically, and tuning out what you're hearing, because you're not hearing what you're playing.
You've sort of just got to know how to feel what to play and not necessarily hear what you're playing. But the hearing part is important when you're registering the organ and figuring out which sounds you want to come out underneath which fingertips and feet.
Right. It is a skill, like a somewhat detached way of playing, but controlling the organ.
Yes.
In a delay of time.
And as a fixer-upper, that's my perspective. Yes, I could barely comprehend how to, you know, I dabble playing the piano, and this is like playing the drums with pianos on your fingertips and conducting 3 symphony orchestras at the same time. It's mind-boggling, and I have so much respect for artists who do this and do this well.
Well, thanks, Matt. Thanks for showing us the whole thing.
Yeah.
Great.
Cool.
You said you recently converted it to have a microcontroller as opposed to, originally it was all electromechanical memory for those selections, correct?
Yes, and the original combination action, they said, I've never seen it, I think we have blueprints of it, but they said it never worked. Right. So I think there's a video online of someone, it might be Keith Chapman in the 80s playing concert here, and he's adjusting all the tabs by hand, which is really crazy. Okay, so this is the inside of the console. So these are the bolster rails that run behind the tabs. So each of the tabs you see on the front has 2 electromagnets, one to turn it on, one to turn it off. And the console runs on vacuum, not on pressure. Sort of like a player piano. It's a small enough system that it can run on vacuum. So it uses the, you know, regular atmospheric pressure to move the tabs instead of building up pressure to counteract the atmosphere and then building on top of that, if that makes any sense. There's vacuum that runs in all these pipes, and then there's actually these oak bolster rails are hollow on the inside, and the electromagnets turn each tab on or off. The tabs, electrically and pneumatically, still work the same way they always have. It's just the signal that goes to them to turn them on or off is, you know, recorded and recalled electronically now instead of mechanically. But so each of those tabs has a pneumatic like this. So this is actually two, so they get screwed in here, and so one of them flips the tab up and another one flips the tab down. And there's a rocker, and we have all the original jigs that they made that you set this in to do the re-leathering.
How many of these are in the console?
I don't know. I think 460. I'm probably wrong.
It's hundreds.
I'm not. Oh yeah, hundreds. Yeah, hundreds for sure. I'm not. I don't know. I'm not pedantic enough to know how
and
many there are.
For maintenance, how often do you typically have to replace those, or if ever?
Well, they redid most of the console in the 90s, I think, in the late 90s. So now if we do something, it's we might take one out and have to patch it here and there. I mean, it's really... Well, here, come on in. It's the console is... It could be worse to work on, but it's not great. We've done some things to try to make it easier, but... So this is the back of the six manuals. It may be hard to see, but there is... each of the keys here, you know, so these are the back of the keys on the keyboard. And there's a little loop of wire with a single wire in the center, and these little bars just short the loop to the center part. And these all have to be regulated because, you know, that you want each key on the keyboard to depress to the same depth as all of it, all of the other keys. And also with sort of the same amount of force required to press it down. So this all has to get carefully adjusted when it comes apart. But so to get at this, you have to, like this panel here, this is the back of the post for the music rack that I showed you. So this unscrews and the wires stay attached and it just kind of, you pull it out, it takes two or three people and it gets kind of pulled out from the front and then we lay it on the top. And then, where are the pivot points, that then the manuals actually lift up so you can get underneath them. But it's a real chore. Recently, one of the... So also there are those memory buttons with the numbers on them. Recently, one of those came detached from the very back on the inside. And we had... And it was the second to lowest keyboard. And we had to unscrew all of them and lift them all up and just barely get in there to fix one little... nut that came loose. I mean, it took, sorry, you know, like 5 hours.
This bar here, it's, I'm looking at the mechanism here, this bar, it goes over to this actuator here that goes all the way up here to this bellows. What is that?
This is the crescendo, which I don't know if he uses it very often, but it's got a big light in the way here, but here are all the contacts. There's a big sort of a brass plate. It's okay, a big brass plate that slides down and contacts.
And these on the bottom, these are the foot controls.
These are the swell shades. So each one has 10 different levels between fully closed and fully open.
Now electromechanical rather than pneumatic. Is there any vacuum in there?
No. This is just your foot presses it, and you know, so it's, you know. It's just a block of maple with a piece of brass on either side and contacts. So this is all, you know, like I said, this is all from the original.
And that, we
shop.
Saw that swell shade controller upstairs last time, and so how does this get translated into that pneumatic actuation happening upstairs?
It just gets sent electrically. I think originally it was 12 volts, but now we have the new electronic relay, so it's probably 5 or something like that. And it goes up.
Is it motor controlled up there? Does it open up valves to...
It depends. There are a lot of different swell shades in the organ. There's some... The original ones were pneumatic. There's a thing called a whiffle tree, which is what I was told it was called. It seems crazy, but there's a thing called a whiffle tree. It's a 10-stage pneumatic motor that turns a big rod that opens and closes the shades. And then we also have some just regular old electric motors that do it. But to answer your question, the signaling is electronic nowadays.
So all these brass tubes, these are all the, this is the, you said it runs off of vacuum, not pressure?
Yeah, this is the vacuum line.
So you have, and upstairs we saw all the generators for the pressure lines. You have another one in the, is it the vacuum generated here in the console?
No, there's a line that goes down and up, and that's on the, in one of the blower rooms on the second floor mezzanine.
So it is one, yeah. So it moves quite a ways.
Yeah.
I also notice, some boards stuck here and there for, those
oh
for
God.
Testing or?
No, that's the, there's a new swell, or no, it's the, we have an indicator up there. So these guys are, forget when they're from, but these are the swell shoe indicators that tell you how far open or closed the different swell shades are.
Right.
And underneath that, there's a little, you know, a bunch of 7-segment displays that show you which memory level you're on.
This is amazing. It's very cramped in here.
Yeah.
Very cramped.
Let's see
this
in the side.
All these solenoids. Or solenoids.
Actually, come on out. Look in from this side, too.
All right. Look at all those pipes. I'm just looking at all the vacuum pipes. They're just. It's amazing. Okay.
So they did their best to make this so you could get at it. It's a little catch. And so you can open this and get at these a little bit. Not a lot of light in there, but you can imagine having to take out or adjust those little tiny screws all the way in there. We did, in 2009, take the console apart. There's actually an oak frame on the inside, and all the mahogany here is just sort of dressing the frame. And it's put together with brass ferrules set into the wood and machine screws that hold it together. So it's made to be taken apart. So all the components came apart, you know, like this whole sort of wing here.
Wow.
There's a camera on there, I won't move it. But so we took it all apart and had the mahogany exterior refinished in 2009 and 10. And while it was apart, you can see there's this piece of aluminum here and these plates. These, if you can see these screws here, they used to go right into the backside of the wood on the front here. And we made some aluminum sort of braces here and made it so these now screw into the aluminum. So you can take this whole wooden kind of corner off and these will stay up. They used to just come loose, which, you know, we had to cut blocks to support them while we did that. But we made it so the wood can now come off. So if we really needed to get in here and we couldn't, just from here, we could actually take this off, but, you know, we try not to have to do that.
I can imagine the disassembling and reassembling nightmare of this, because not only do you have all of the layers of all these relays with the solenoids, but you have all these vacuum lines that are also have to be lined up, and so it looks like an alignment nightmare from the front and the back.
Yeah, and it's got to be airtight. And then, so if you come over here, this actually never got completely reconnected.
Or dusted.
Or dusted, probably. You can see some of... Some of the pneumatics and the magnets, and you can also see these beautiful giant-sized half-blind dovetails that were used to construct the console. Yeah.
And this console was built here in this building in the organ factory on the 12th floor.
12th?
In the late 20s. It's the third console that this organ has had because the organ has been expanded since its original installation in 1911.
This is the third console?
Yes.
Hmm. was just a total treat. Thanks, guys. Yeah. Thanks. Wow. Really something. Wanamaker Organ.
The idea is you have a whole lot of them on hand, so if they go bad, you can just open the chest and replace the ones that are bad. A little bit of a mess, but this is the shop.
It's like a wood shop to me.
So this is the wood shop.
That does look like it's got some history to it.
Oh, the workbench?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were five or six of those here in the old shop that were just kind of piled with junk. And so I took this one and flattened the top years ago. And it's probably not flat anymore, but flat on the top and cleaned it up and use it for what it was originally intended, which is nice.
There's just so many hours in a bench like this.
Yeah.
You can only even imagine. Wow.
That's true. I saved from Sam. That is part of a mechanical combination action from a whirlet. No, that's from a molar. A molar theater organ that we took out of a church in Baltimore and rebuilt and installed in St. Clement's Church on 20th and Cherry.
It's very intricate.
Yeah, it's a mechanical, it's basically a mechanical memory. We didn't actually rebuild it, we just took it out and put in an electronic combination action, but it was too nice to throw away. So
mechanical memory. So what would something like this actually control? What would it need to remember?
Well, the stops, meaning like the voices in the organ that are on or off.
Oh, okay. That's a player piano.
It is. A little one. I got that from Craigslist. If you keep your eye on Craigslist, you can get player pianos for free.
Really?
Sometimes it's like, get this thing out of here.
So this is a free player piano.
Yeah.
We'll fix her upright.
And wouldn't hold. I mean, player pianos work on vacuum, not on pressure. But it wouldn't hold.
Right, because the paper roll, and it works on.
Yeah.
Right. So you use the same vacuum for the paper roll as you use for the bellows, and like to actually work the mechanism.
Exactly. And this wouldn't work because there were too many holes in the reservoir. So we actually got two shop vacs and plugged them into the two. Ports that connect to what the reservoir was, and I forget how many inches a player piano works on, the inches of vacuum, but it's not that many, but I think a vacuum is like 70 inches or something. So we were running it on like way, way, way too much vacuum, and it made it play super loud and way too fast, but it was kind of fun.
So I spotted this, and this is an all plywood. Is it plywood? It's all solid.
Yeah, this has channeling in it, but...
But it's an all-wood vacuum pump.
A big wheel here that would be driven by a motor. This is the base right here. The motor would go on, and then the unit.
And on the inside, it's got this, it's got the two pumps, I guess.
Four.
And four.
Yeah, right.
Four-way. Look at that.
So as it spins, it is drawing the air. And of course, this is old and leaky. But it would be drawing the air out of this and compressing it, and this wants to go and open back up. So this is a vacuum reservoir.
Huh. Wow.
So it builds up.
So is this
more and more nothing?
Is this the original vacuum? One of the original vacuum?
No. I think this is from a. We just have a lot of stuff here. I don't know. I don't know where that came from. This isn't from the organ. It's just.
But it's just a vintage vacuum pump.
Yeah.
Four bellows. That's pretty cool. Pretty neat. Modulation. Repulsion start modulation. Single phase motor. I've never heard it called that before. Repulsion start modulation.
Andy,
maybe? Yeah. He's copacetic. What the hell is this? This is part of the...
This is a big chest that we took out of the chorus division that we rebuilt, haven't put back in yet.
This is what the other side, we saw. Just saw the console. This is what's on the other side. This is what the receiving end of those controls.
Similarly, yeah, same magnets, different thing.
I love these magnets. Are these all, I guess these were not like maybe handmade or custom made. Do you think they're custom made, or are these kind of units like off-the-shelf Bible at one point for the...
I think they were. I don't think these were...
Because of thousands and thousands of these things.
Yeah, there are.
So we've been...
There's a lot of junk. We've been here since... in this space since 2006. I've been here since 2005. When I started, the organ shop was in a little room on the second floor mezzanine, kind of tucked like around this corner. And to get to it, you had to actually go up some stairs, out a fire door, across an exterior fire escape, back in a door and around a corner, and then there was a sliding door and the organ shop was there. And the things we had to restore, you literally couldn't get around that first corner. There just were too long to go around the corner. In 2006, we got some grant money to kind of get started in earnest with the restoration of the organ. They had been having symposiums for a while before that, but that's when we started setting up a shop. So we finally, we renovated the third floor mezzanine here and then moved our stuff up from the old shop space. I don't know.
I hear something crackling, something's...
The crackling is this, hide glue over here, I'm sure. We use hot melt, traditional hot melt hide glue. So Michael Lawrence must have just left. This is still a little warm, but it's just animal protein glue. It's unglamorous, but it's a traditional adhesive, and you can hydrate it and remove it with water. Water and heat, you can remove it.
So you keep that hot, and then you apply it hot to...
I think about 140 is about where it's supposed to be. So 135.
See, what are these?
These are called Fleming pneumatics, named after William Boone Fleming, the gentleman in the photograph over there. The way this organ works, and most organs these days, the way they work is you've got wind coming from blowers that puts pressure into wind chests that have valves that connect to underneath the pipes. And so the wind in the chest is allowed at the right moment to blow through the pipe and play a note. And the same wind that plays the pipes is also what creates most of the mechanical movement in the organ. So you've got a sealed tight wind chest that has pneumatics like this inside it. So this is just a wooden block with a leather pouching on it and a leather valve. And inside there from the back, there is a weak spring. You probably have some of those in here. And we reuse all the parts that we can from the original organ. And like I often say when people ask what my job is, I say my job is to meticulously reproduce the mistakes of the past. So we try to reuse as many things as possible. So there's a weak spring in there, and then the inside of the pneumatic block is connected to this opening here, which gets screwed to the inside of a chest, and this valve covers a hole, rather. And there's channeling that connects the inside of the pneumatic through this hole to the inside of the chest, so everything's in equilibrium. But there's when the organist plays a note, it sends 12 volts to an electromagnet, which lifts a little metal armature, which changes the channeling and connects the inside of the pneumatic to the atmosphere. So now you've got atmospheric pressure, which is lower inside the pneumatic, surrounded by high pressure in the chest, and so it collapses the pneumatic just because of the pressure differential.
And that allows that turns on the note.
Yeah, so that pulls the valve away from the opening inside the chest and lets the wind in the chest blow through that hole and play a note.
So it's two different levels of pressure at work. One for control, one for actually playing the organ.
No, they're the same.
Oh, the same.
Yeah, so this is in the wind chest. We can actually probably film inside. I can find something to open up that you can film, and I can describe this again when there's something to look at besides me holding thing in the air.
And these are all like hand carved, hand worked pieces. It's like
They're all original. They're just blocks of pine or poplar that were drilled out, and then they've been modified a bunch of times over the years. They used to have a little adjustable tension spring in here and a bunch of other parts that were long ago discarded. So Fleming, the guy in the photo over there, was very well known for engineering things that were so complicated that they didn't work. Or they did work, but they were over-engineered and over-complicated. And so they ended up, over the years, kind of removing some of the parts of these and simplifying them, and they work just as well. So that's what all this, I mean, it looks like it's had a long life, and it has. But
it has. How old are these parts? When was the organ assembled originally?
The organ was built in about three stages. The first part of the organ was built 1902-03 in Los Angeles, and was set up and working at the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis. After that, Wanamaker acquired it, brought it here, got it set up in the store, and playing, I think, by 1911 was the sort of dedication. And then he felt like it wasn't loud enough, and so he started his own organ building shop in the building. At one point, there were 30 full-time employees, is what the book says. And they, in that shop, had two separate enlargement projects. So the organ is now almost 29,000 pipes. It started out about 10,000.
29,000 pipes.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's a lot. And then there's got to be some sort of pneumatic valve to open and close the, you know, to allow or disallow the wind to play the pipes.
In every single one.
Yeah. And the leather lasts about 60 years, best case scenario.
Best case.
Yeah. If you do it right. If you did it wrong, it takes 10 years to find out. You know, and it's things like, I mean, it sounds silly, but you've got, you know, hide glue in here, and you're gluing the leather to the pneumatic, and if you pull the brush away, it can kind of like make a little sort of string of hide glue, you know? And if you do that without paying attention and it dries to a little sharp point, the leather will wear out there more quickly than it should. But so it means that in 10 years, your pneumatics start failing instead of 50 or 60. But it still takes 10 years to find out that you didn't do it right. Like I said, there's lots of leather work. So we've got, it's like our leather station. We have a whole suite of punches.
Wow.
And they do get pretty big. Wow. We don't use them very often, but I know.
Yeah, I have some of these up to like an inch in size, yeah. But.
Probably have to hit that pretty hard to make it.
Yeah, I don't.
Do its job. Yeah. But here. I don't know, this in terms of leather work and punching, this is my favorite thing that we have. So you can take your one of these and one of those. And that's got a little bayonet. And now you can make your own washers.
Ha!
With whatever inside and outside diameter that you want.
Oh, what? Okay.
The cabinets here, these drawers, they all have these individual locks, and I think the keys are long gone. But he said that this was originally in the women's department, and they would give you a key, and you could lock your purse in here while you were shopping.
Wow.
Or trying on.
Historic.
So this is a bottom board that Ryan, these are actually new. These are for a high school that has a pipe organ in the Northeast. My shopmate Ryan built this thing, all of these. So this is a different type of organ than the Wanamaker organ, but these are electromagnets, and here's the common, and there's leather gaskets. So everything in the organ, or in an organ that needs to be put together and airtight, they pretty much make leather or cork gaskets, mostly leather these days, I believe. So that's what these are. This is the outer part of it. So here's the bottom of the magnets, and these unscrew so you can change the armatures.
So this is actually hollow.
Well, this gets screwed up. Well, we'll see more of this when we go in the organ. This gets screwed underneath a wind chest, and the holes in the gasket here each correspond to one of these magnets.
So there's actually there are tunnels inside of the board that channel the air.
They're drilled diagonally through the plywood.
Wow.
It takes a long time to make. So each of these holes here goes to one of these magnets, and basically when the magnet gets 12 volts, it lifts a little armature. Let's see if we can find one down here. So this would be, is it in there? Yeah, so see the little metal armature.
Okay.
So there's a, just get put back in there properly. This is upside down now. This would be, overhead and like that onto the bottom of a chest. So generally, with pipe organs, you access the chests from underneath because on top, you've got all the pipes. So to open up
to get inside the chest from the top is a real pain because you have to take all the pipes off, put them in trays, take them out. Also, when you touch them, they go out of tune. So you can imagine tuning 29,000 pipes. It doesn't really happen very often. At least they're not, I mean, it's rarely, I mean, isn't it can't ever really be perfectly in tune because it's just too big. But anyway, these would go underneath the wind chest. And so what the electromagnets do is basically open this channel to the atmosphere by moving that little armature up or down under the magnet. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
We can look at something else that might show that better. But that's the, I mean, that's the main principle that all of this stuff works on.
This works pretty well in low light.
Oh, there you go. I saw and your main amp meter was running about 40 amps when the organ was playing.
Yeah, 12 volts.
But if that gauge is any...
Yeah, I think it can draw about 100 when it's going.
I was going to say the ampere meter goes to 400 amps, but does it ever really need that much?
Not that I've ever seen.
This is the 2D, which is a thing that will let you play all of the organ on one manual. But you have to have someone come back here and manually adjust. You know, those are switches.
Right.
So you have to have someone come back here and manually set it.
So this is just for this one console here. So you can play it from inside the organ? Or this is a...
Well, no, this is attached to the console.
Oh, okay.
You know, the main console. And there's a tab that says 2D. I think there's three or four of them, maybe? Three, maybe? Yeah, so there's 2D1, 2D2.
And... Oh, I see 2D. It says right there on the...
So you can come back here and set... I mean, these are actual switches. Just when you turn this, it just closes the contact. So you can come back here and set things ahead of time. But generally, I think the organists don't really use it. But it's actually very handy for troubleshooting because the whole... all the switching or the signaling for the whole organ comes through here. So I think in the, you know, the idea of dividing things in half to find where the problem is, you know?
Right.
So you divide it in half and then you find which half and then you divide that in half to try to chase out a problem. This isn't, I think, technically like in half, but it's an easy place to get to.
There's a bunch of different types of chests in the organ here. And this, the design on this, it doesn't actually have brass ferrules. It has these little clips you just turn. But I like these nice quarter sawn oak panels here. So take this down. You can see everything is recently re-leathered. So in here you've got... So if you look in here, you can see there's a row of electromagnets. Each corresponds to a note. And so this magnet, when it gets 12 volts, will, through a channel in the wood, exhaust this pneumatic, which moves this little threaded rod. And it only has to move that tiny amount. So that closes. So this pneumatic here is connected through a channel in the wood to this opening. So when this pneumatic collapses, it closes this opening and opens one up here, which goes to the atmosphere. So then the channel to this pneumatic is connected to atmosphere, so it collapses. And that pulls this rod, which opens this valve here, which then opens the channel through the backboard here up to the channel in the bottom board, then exhausts to atmosphere. So it's primary, secondary, pneumatic, which then exhausts the channel that runs through. Maybe I should get a screwdriver. I can take a bottom board down.
Oh, that's the bottom board for the pipes. So.
The Fleming screwdriver's not in here either. Hand tools.
It's another one of those great desks.
Yeah.
You want to put them in a cup or... Absolutely.
Or do you want to film?
I'm doing both. Okay. I'm multitasking.
This is an
in a supreme way. So those are tapped into like a brass or steel.
There are brass ferrules in the
chest. So they built this to be constantly maintained. Mm-hmm. I was reading the book, so I've gotten a little bit of background about how it's put together and sort of for the exposition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a showpiece for sure.
So the interesting thing to me is that from the very beginning, they've always had a fake facade for the organ, because in the exposition they had a facade, and mm-hmm. here they built a completely different one for this location. So it just seems, well, maybe it's not odd, but that from the beginning they knew that they would have to present something to the public to make them
something more than what was
instead of just like instead of a wall of louvers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is it did say in the book that the at one point in the exhibition the organist hit a low note and a part of the ceiling detached from the exhibition hall.
That sounds as legendary as it more legendary than true, but yeah, I did see that in the book.
Yeah,
it maybe.
Well, it makes a good story. Yeah.
Not the ceiling falling down. I just mean the organ in general.
Well, for an organist, it makes a good story to say that, you know, that they literally brought the house down. Yeah. Literally.
So, we got all the bolts out. Yeah, we gotta get like a
little stubby to get in there.
Where's that right angle one you found?
Yeah, that could work. It's a little.
Yeah, I don't like those either personally, but
it's a little small for how big those are. But
a pinch.
It's quicker than a trip to the shop.
Well, just to get it going, and then you know.
So when we rebuilt a division, we basically do all of this at once. We take this whole thing apart all at once and take all of it up to the shop. Basically put it in the hallway in a giant pile. Actually, your camera is small enough. You could probably poke it up in there and have a look at the channels.
Oh.
Okay.
Well, I got one left in there in the corner. There's that one right there.
What, this?
No, closer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, thank you. There's those. Okay. So, here's the last bolt.
That is so thick. It's like 2 inches thick.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's laminated. You can see from the edge. So there's channeling through there.
Oh, it's a box. It's like a hollow box. So there are channels carved in there to distribute the wind to the different pipes.
Yeah, so each of these holes is connected by a channel, and they all go to pipes of the same pitch. But you can see the spaces here correspond with the chests that have the different ranks on them. So, if you look...
Wow,
so there are the Flemings.
There's a lot in there.
Yeah. So, I should look. We have a Fleming screwdriver somewhere. I'll have to go get it from upstairs. But so these are the Fleming blocks that you saw Mike rebuilding in the shop.
Yeah.
And so the bottom board mates with these holes. And it's funny because we rebuilt this in 2010, 11 maybe, and look how dirty it's gotten already.
That's just from the air.
That's just dirt in the air, yeah.
Well, that's the city.
So each of these holes goes up into one of those pneumatics, and they're all connected by a channel through the board. And then if you can get the camera up here and look, you can see, like, if you see, actually, this is nice. It's old from the original organ. There's these punching notes. So there is, you can feel an opening here, which would mate with gasketic part of the end of the bottom board.
So that's a D.
See right here, so these are the channels. So magnet gets 12 volts, which collapses this pneumatic, basically opens this pneumatic to the atmosphere, so it collapses because it's got pressure around it, so it collapses, which opens this valve, which collapses this pneumatic, which opens this bigger valve underneath here, which goes through the backboard that this is mounted to, and up to this opening here, which mates with the hole in the bottom board, which exhausts that whole channel to atmosphere. So now you've got all these pneumatics in the chests that are trying to be played all at once, but only the chests that have pressure in them, because the stop tab is turned on, will actually collapse the pneumatic and make the
That's how the paddle controls work then at the organ console. They determine which ones turn on and off and they hit them specifically.
Exactly. This is a ventil chest. So this thing here is called the stop action. So this, when you turn on one of the stops, will put wind into the corresponding chest.
So it's a grid. It's a matrix. So
exactly.
You've got notes this way and you have selections this way.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right.
Exactly. And it only puts wind into, at least in this type of chest, it only puts wind into the chests that have ranks that are turned on. So you don't have to have the whole organ pressurized all at once, which
makes good sense. And that's for every single division has its own set of controls like this. So mm-hmm. So how many divisions are there? Separate.
Oh, well, there's 460 ranks.
460 ranks.
I believe, yeah. But as for divisions, I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, that's it. Thanks for tuning in and being patient and waiting for part two of the Wanamaker Organ. Thanks to Scott and Matt. And I'm Fran. I'll be back. Thanks for watching. Bye.